Okay, so today I will talk not as a chair of Decision Camp, but as a CTO of Open Rules, one of the vendor of decisioning platform. And but I still will try to talk about more general trends in decision modeling and in decisioning in general, but still through open rules lenses. And I will share our experience. Okay. So first day when I presented the digital decisioning platforms, I mentioned all directions where we all work hardly, and it's first of all it's decision modeling with different techniques and using different tools, including traditional rule engines or new rule engines, and of course machine learning becomes really a big player in this area, plus CP and LP solvers. We will hear several presentations today and tomorrow about this, and as always, business orientation and performance scalability is very important. But what I want to talk about today, it's something special what we as practitioner can see when we go to real world customers. And this is basically shift to CI/CD world. And in this world, this orchestrations and choreography of multiple services, continuous integration, delivery, deployment, and of course security become really big issue. So how our intelligent decision services can become a good citizens of this environment, new CI/CD world, that's the topic of my presentation. And to support this environment, one of new strong issue is how we do testing, because this testing becomes repeatable and automated, and it keeps all these pipelines, if you wish, together. So during the last 5 years, we all concentrated on business decision models, how to create these models, and we discussed different techniques, and this was our main focus. And we concentrated on different technologies. Of course, testing and explanations always a very important issue. But what actually happened, our interest stayed here. And we said, even we started to create this one-click mechanisms and said, we can deploy our decision model everywhere, does not matter. AWS, Lambda, Docker, Azure functions, we're good everywhere. Majority of vendors have these facilities, but at least in our company, we had this attitude. Whatever, we are just normal decision service or microservice, use it as you wish. Our work done. We're not interested really as a business people, not really interested in deployment. It's done and use it, let IT people to use it. And this was the attitude for quite a while. And what we started to see is that this actually quite changing quite quickly. Major enterprises in the last 2 years really moved to CI/CD world, where they concentrate on continuous integration, delivery, deployment, and all these technologies. This is something what is here to stay. And CI/CD, as you know, this is DevOps methodology, and it enables ongoing automation to support life cycle of application. And from integration and testing phases to delivery and deployment. What is really valuable about CI/CD is that it streamlines the complexity of software integration and delivery, creating so-called pipeline models. And it allows a smooth flow of changes in code, but also in business logic. And because business logic today frequently is represented inside business decision models, this affects all of us. And so I will talk about this new trend and how we should react to this new trend. Of course, the most important key word now is continuous. It's not a new word. Even Evans in his famous book started to talk about continuous development. But now this is a key word, and how everything started to change and what shift we can see in creation of decision microservices. We started to concentrate more on orchestration and choreography of the services. Choreography also works when we have a live stream of events and we have to react, our services should react to these events and subscribe, publish them. And continuous testing becomes very important. It's not only testing of our model, it's also testing of already deployed decision services, and it brings new requirements. And again, continuous integration. It's not once and done. It's not just one click. It's continuous click when we have new changes and also new security requirements of our deployed services may affect our business logic. And so basically I can see this shift, and to support now, not just previously we supported life cycle of our decision models. Now we should really support the life cycle of decision services. And let me share just a recent experience of, we had actually even this year with two really large US enterprises. And for example, one of them decided to use Open Rules to create completely new decision service for very sophisticated logic. And they had team, they already were well prepared, they knew all technologies, and they created the proper teams of business analysts and software developers. And it was not surprising to me when after 1 month or 1.5 months, the decision model itself worked perfectly well. They had this quite complex logic already implemented in Open Rules, decision tables, and all other mechanism. We deployed this initially, but by default, we deploy everything as Lambda. Everything was fine. The deployment environment was AWS, but not AWS only. We should be ready for other options, and we did everything smoothly. But then we were surprised that we spent even more than 2 or 3 months to putting these already deployed services in real production environment. And this took much longer time because we have to know we have to know about this deployment, what is the deployment context, how our decision model as a service would be invoked in this context. And based on this invocation context, we need to change logic inside business decision model. And I will talk about this as we go today. So basically, based on this experience, I wanted to introduce this term continuous digital decisioning. So along with these three well-known boxes, continuous integration, delivery, and deployment, I think we need to talk about continuous decision modeling when this era becomes extremely important. Because our model should be aware of context from which it may be invoked. If we don't do it, it would not work in reality. Now, our business analysts, previously they talked usually with software developers during the integration time, but now to these real meetings, we always, our customers always involve DevOps people who really are in charge of runtime, QA and runtime environment. And when they talk to business analysts, they discuss such issues, for example, as security. What can what we can show to end user, what information is allowed to go through network. It's extremely important and touchable issue for them, because in our unsecured world, you don't want to pass everything through network, because bad people can catch this information. And these people sometimes, I would not say paranoid, but they really worried about security, and this is a real world requirement. So in this environment, I would say that our context-aware decision models should follow context-aware systems known for many years. And it means they should have the ability to sense and adapt to the production environment. And this is a basically major message of my presentation. And I want to specify, talking about continuous decision modeling and decisioning in general, I would specify four topics of interest here. And probably other people can add more, but this is a kind of outline of my presentation. It would not be long, but I would talk about decision service integration. When we integrate, when integration and invocation logic of different decision services is business logic by itself, and it can be implemented as another decision service, or using, and we can compare this decision service with other integration implementations. Then we will talk about invocation context and how to represent this context-aware systems. And I also will talk about security issues, and I will show you some examples of them. And of course, testing in CI/CD world is the number one priority, and we will talk about these four issues. Let's start with integration. The question is, when we have multiple decision services, they could be deployed in cloud or on-premise, and they all have their own very well-specified functionality. And the question is how to integrate them. We all know that these problems exist and how usually integration works. We frequently use BPM system for integration. We frequently, not frequently, but lately, we started to use AWS step functions. This is, by the way, last year I mentioned this, and it was a really important target for integration logic, because AWS steps functions support state machines. But when you build simple state machine, it's nice. But when it becomes a little bit more difficult, suddenly this logic, we can see it's a business logic and being represented in AWS environments that works fine, still it's awkward and cannot be supported by business people. So probably this is not the best option, but it depends on every particular situation as always. Can it be represented in Java? Of course, we do have several integration projects when people use Java for integration and they call services, but in this case, the logic is implemented in Java, but is not the best choice again. It's unavailable to business people. Can we use Kafka? That's one of the most attractive mechanism, and together with publish subscribe, it gives us extremely powerful option. And but at the same time, if we see that this integration logic is basically business logic, why not to extract business part of this logic and give control over this part to business users? And that's something what I want to show you. For example, let's look on notorious loan origination decision model described in DMN section 11. We're all aware of this model. I just will show you a top-level diagram. This diagram was built automatically by Open Rules Explorer, and this is top-level diagram. You can see our goal is loan origination result, and decline or accept, and or some other outputs. But what is important to come up with this logic, this decision table probably, or would execute two separate services. One service, we can call this as pre-processing service or bureau strategy service, and another service is routing service. And you don't always need routing service if you decline, if results of bureau strategy service is declined, so it doesn't, it's not necessary to run routing service. They all share these four major objects or business concepts, the applicant application requests, but the concept as bureau data needed only for routing service. And the only, so that's quite familiar diagram, and this is top level diagram. And in our, in open rules, graphical tools, we show elements deployed as services as a green one. And contrary to blue decision tables, for example. But for us, service is the same business knowledge model as decision table or any other BKMs. So let's look on this a little bit deeper. If you look on business pre-bureau decision service that specifies bureau strategy, this is a diagram that looks familiar to many people, and I'm not going through details of this diagram. I just want to tell that this diagram is complex enough and deserves to be presented as a separate decision service. And if you look on post-processing decision diagram, it specifies routing as its major goal. It uses, shares a lot of services and sub goals, the same with what was in pre-processing decision logic. And it's also being complex enough, deserves its own service. And what is important that these diagrams can share common glossary. And in this glossary, we represent all our concept, applicant, application, requested product, bureau data, and they have different decision variables. Different, they have the internal technical names, they have different types, and all other attributes. Of course, they have description in plain English, they have other possible domains, some default values, but this is the simplest basic glossary what we represent. And now let's talk about integration logic. If you look on this integration logic described in DMN section 11, basically this logic can be presented in plain English like this. And you can see it's in plain English. So for example, we should first execute bureau strategy service, and if this service will determine bureau strategy, our decision variable, and if this strategy is declined, then we should stop execution, we should report final result as decline, and not to do anything. If it's not decline, then we go to post-processing routing service, etc. And this logic actually it corresponds to what Alan described as a very in his presentation as a decide, collect, act approach. And this certainly another demonstration of what Alan did, and it could be represented in diagram. And Alan demonstrated how quickly this diagram become complex, but he also presented nice decision table that can represent this logic. In our case, it's really very similar to what Alan presented. This is a special table. It has two conditions and one and two conclusions. In this situation, it's interesting to look on the second, on the first conclusion, or we call this action execute. This is in open rules. We have different types of conditions and different type of conclusions, and one of them execute any business decision table or business knowledge model, whatever it doesn't matter how it's represented. In this case, we just first we unconditionally execute bureau strategy service. It will specify variable bureau strategy, and then we check if it's decline, then just make final result decline and don't do anything else. In all other cases, if it's not decline, we need to execute, first of all, we need to execute routing service. And if routing service will specify variable routing, and if it's decline, we will specify final result like this, refer like this, and if it's accept, like this. So this is a quite straightforward logic, but in real world, it's much, much more complicated integration logic. What is interesting here? These two business knowledge models actually implemented as decision services, but we don't care in this moment how they implemented. In this logic, we gave them name, Bureau Strategy Service, Routing Service, and it's up to implementation to know how to invoke this service. And also what is important that when we with this action execute is smart enough to recognize which type of BKM it has and how it should be invoked. That's basically nice integration of traditional, nice use of traditional decision tables to represent complex integration logic. Okay, but then we have a question. If we can use freely this decision services as BKM, somewhere we should specify. Still, how would system know what does it mean, bureau strategy or routing service? And we create a special table, we call this decision service, and we can list here different decision services. So each service has name, the same name what you've seen in previous decision table, and it has different types. First, we support multiple types, and this is the most simple one. If it's implemented as Lambda, we can actually use here Lambda names by default, and it would use automatically will invoke Lambda. But let's say this is, of course, even business people can create this, but let's say then, people from DevOps people will come and tell, no, we need more efficient call of these services, and I want you to use directly ARN, it means AWS specific invocation mechanism. And in this case, service point can be presented in this complex formula, what only DevOps people know, and they just will tell business people to put here ARN address. In this case, it's still Lambda, and because Lambda has different specification of endpoints, we can easily recognize what endpoint should be used. But also, what if we don't want to know about this and we can use any REST endpoints? In this case, we can have type REST, and here we can use another representation endpoint of service. It does not matter how it was deployed as a Lambda or as on EC2 and any other or through Docker. It doesn't matter, it's just REST endpoint. And more than that, sometimes people want to use directly Java, and OpenRules can, because we do generate Java interfaces during deployment mechanism, so we actually generate special Java classes, and if you want, you can use these classes for invocation. In this case, we call this service type. In reality, we have more parameters here specifying which business objects need to minimize overhead of an network, but this is all details. The most important part, we do have special table that specifies decision services. And these two tables together, traditional invocation from decision tables using action execute and specification of services in this decision service tables, solve a lot of integration problems. Not all of them, but it's really convenient and our customers appreciate this approach. Okay. That's about integration. Next big topic is invocation context. So now we will talk about context-aware decision modeling. Our business decision models maintained by business users. And usually they, as I mentioned, they don't want to know about deployment just it's not their responsibility. And at the same time, DevOps people don't want to know about business logic, but they still should work together. And what we found that frequently is that actually business people themselves won't tell DevOps people what should be secured. For example, if they have certain information inside the request, they're ready to pass this information to decision service, but they don't want this decision service to display this in explanations or in any in reports or in any other way to certain user. Only authorized users can see this information. And if you remember the question what Alan asked about intellectual property, how you during the explanation mechanism. So it's not only intellectual property. Intellectual property is one of concern, but it's also security concerns that's very important. So my statement is decision. Business decision model frequently should be aware of the operational context from which the corresponding decision service will be invoked. And this is very important question. And if this is important, how to find, how to address this question? If you start to write something on DevOps site, on specific in AWS or any other environment, it could be quite complex and certainly not available to business people. We go back to our old good time when business specifies and IT implements. We don't want this. So what is the right place where to define this is invocation logic? And our answer is decision model glossary. And when we saw how easy and it can be reuse our quite universal glossary for this information, to present this information, this was really, I would not, probably not breakthrough, but something what we love and more importantly, our customer love. So let's consider some example. So usually decision model glossary describes all use decision variables, but glossary may also describe how these variables can be used. For example, in OpenRules, we have, for a long time, we have this special column, and we call this column useDes. And in useDes column, we have different possible values. For example, in, it means this variable used as an input variable. Required, so it means this input required. Sometimes it could be just, if it's not provided, we can use default value, like for example here. If start date of service not provided, that's, we will assume that this is default value. And but then we're coming to output. If out, it means this variable not only is out, but it should be included in our response from our decision service. It's very important. And finally, there is a value constant, const, that tells that this is this variable should be initialized only once. For example, when we define maximum age, and it's 120, for example, yesterday we saw a nice presentation when maximum age was 100 from KU Leuven, but by instead of hard coding this, they could use max age and changing this to 120, it would be easy. But important thing is that this is a constant, you define it once and you never have to redefine it again. Okay, but my point is that used S can be used for different purposes. And now we decided to expand functionality of this used S to support different context. To do this, as I said, it could be very important for security and performance issue. So to do this, we allowed that our glossaries to have multiple used S columns. And this column, for example, this used as used for, this is just example, it could be anything. And our customers use it certainly differently, but for this, for example, famous vacation days example, it's very simple example when based on age and years of service, we specified how many vacation days to give each customers. And they're eligible to some basic days, but they're also eligible to extra 5 days, 3 days, 2 days, based on some interesting logic. But when we specified used as on-premise or on-cloud, we can use this example just to, for demonstration purposes. Let's say on if it works, if it's deployed on-premise, and we want, for example, we put here additional variable, and we call this invocation source. It's just regular decision variable, nothing more. And if invocation source, we can define it as by default it's premise. And if it's defined on premise, if the service will be used deployed on premise, then we want to display everything. All these intermediate results would go to response because we put here out, so they will go to response. But in on cloud, we don't want to include these three variables. This is just example, but it could be quite valuable example. And in this case, the only question what we have, if you specify everything inside glossary, how would we know what used as column to use? To do this, we have simple decision table. We call this use the selector. And this table, it's a regular decision table. It can check the variable in our situation. We call this invocation source. So we will check if invocation source is cloud, then we have special action used as. And this action will use used as for cloud as our used as column. It means only this column would be used here. In all other cases, if we put here premise, or maybe we can have other invocation context, it will use used as for premise. So this simple mechanism opened doors to our business users, to ability for our business users to specify, to respect the invocation context. And so let me show a little demo. This is implementation, and let me skip for a second, and I would call, this is a Postman, and in Postman, what do we have? We deployed this, in this case, it was local, deployed locally on localhost 8080, and we call this service, this is our JSON, as an input of this body, and you can see it has employee has ID, date of birth, start date, but it also has a settings called, and we interested in invocation source. In this case, it's cloud. Let me make it premise. And when I click send, so it produces immediately results, and these results, let's look on response. Response is, it shows in our response employee, including all these explanations, basically. Vacation days were specified as 24 days, but eligible for extra days, no. Eligible for extra 3 days, no. But this customer was eligible to extra 2 days, as this was true. And that's why on top of mandatory 22 days, this particular user received two more days. Of course, if I change date, let's say that he was born in 80, I'm not, maybe even 70. And let's see what will happen here. Oh, no, still 24 days. But maybe if this customer started to work earlier in 1990, let's see if... our system gave this customer 30 vacation days. But so this is kind of traditional things, but what if I change my invocation source to cloud? In this case, when I click send, the same decision service will work differently. It produces the same vacation day 30, but it does not show anymore these intermediate variables. And if we assume that they are part of our security concerns, that's good. But also you don't want to show everybody what you do. And this is simple combination of glossary and regular decision table addresses this invocation context issue. I was quite impressed how our customers use this mechanism for much complex invocation context what they do have for integration, because the same service is being called from absolutely different sources, and they frequently even want to hide the name of these sources. Okay, let's continue. So this was our table and demo. So let's consider a little bit more difficult question, the same loan origination example. In this case, we had two different contexts, one for pre-bureau, one for post-bureau. And our table we introduced, in this case, it was in vacation context, we introduced this variable service stage, and service stage, based on service stage, if it's pre-bureau or post-bureau, we can tell our service what used S column to use. And in this case, it immediately becomes quite clear. For example, bureau strategy, it's output only for bureau strategy, and this should be used as output. And only in routing, we're interested in this output. But for example, bureau data is required. All these attributes are required only for post-bureau. So combinations of all these different used S columns inside glossary specifies affects dramatically our logic. You can actually imagine much more complex situation here. Let's say you have different roles, and the same decision model should maintain communication with different types of users. If this underwriter can see probably everything. Agent, we don't want to show agent everything, because agent can use our system in the way how we don't want this to use. So we don't want to show agent everything. And certainly our applicant will see only limited information. If we had the 4 or 5 choices, it does not mean applicant will see the best one. So all these logical concerns could be addressed with this simple mechanism. Again, what I want to tell, that our business knowledge, business model should be aware of invocation context. And now let's talk about security. Security is, there are different ways to secure, but two of the most popular security mechanism is JWT, it's JSON Web Tokens authentication. And it's really the most common way to secure access to RESTful web services. And another HTTPS protocol to communicate with secure services. And this is two commonly used services today. And what is the good news? That Spring Boot provides the most popular Java framework. We don't have to invent anything. We just have to communicate with this framework. But how we can hook decision service to this framework? And I will show you quickly how it can be done. Usually, for example, Spring Boot has this predefined class, Web Security Configurer Adapter. And when this class is provided by Spring Boot, our only responsibility to extend this class with our own security config, for example, this class what we created. And in this class, we will have access to JWT tokens. And then we can create one convenience method, and we can call it is authentication, and it will go to JWT token defined inside this class to find out if this user is authenticated or not. And for example, let's look on the same example what Vacation Day gave us. In this case, for example, we added here how to do this hook. We actually need access to this method is authenticated. And if we can create special methods, and we can call this methods from there. But we have nice facilities when we in glossary, we can, instead of regular business concept, we can use formulas. In this case, this is sign for formulas, or we call them Java snippet, and we introduced business concept for business user. User is authenticated. So this variable can be used as normal variable everywhere, but this variable does not have the proper attribute. It has type Boolean, but it will call is authenticated methods, and business people not supposed to know, but in reality, it's just if class pass for this Java classes include this environment, then this method become automatically available. What is nice about this, everything defined in glossary. It's, of course, technical people can help business people with this specification of all these formulas. And what is nice here, we have two different used as methods, one for authenticated users and one for anonymous users. And for to anonymous users, we don't want to show in some fields in the response. In this case, for example, this thing. So if I go back to Postman, I can demonstrate you that these fields would not be shown because the user is not authenticated. And of course, to in this case, simple decision table, is user authenticated true? We call this used as list, and if it's false, we use this. So as simple as that, and sometimes simplicity tells you that probably we're doing something right. And finally, about continuous testing. Testing in CI world never starts and basically never ends. So developer, as I said, DevOps people don't want to know business logic, but they want somebody to write their JUnit test, for example, to test the services. It means that the same test cases that business people specify to test their business decision models should be automatically transformed to the format used by DevOps people. And for example, so what we did, we automatically converted our Excel-based test cases to corresponding Java classes, and they automatically called during CI/CD process. That's how we support repeatable and automated testing. Of course, probably the other products do something similar, but this is kind of a summary of all our environments. Now, let me, as a conclusion on this slide, to show you that our continuous world includes also continuous decision modeling part. This era becomes much more important because it affects everything, including scope of project. And we basically specified new requirements and possible solution for how modern digital decision platforms can help the users to create and maintain good citizens of CI/CD world. That's my presentation. Thank you.
Great, Jacob. That was really good. It's certainly a lot of material there in terms of how decision services are actually going to fit into this more of this agile and continuous development, like you say, the CI/CD sort of pipeline. Are you seeing some really successful uses of this? Is some specific use cases with some of your customers?
Yes, that's exactly, it comes from real world. I don't think, as I said, we had to change our philosophy because we thought our customers would never want to know about invocation context and about security. It's not our business, usually our customers, previously our customers said. And today we can see complete shift in mentality of customers, especially big corporate customers. If you don't support pipelines properly with testing, with invocation context, you probably don't have a choice to be a platform what they will select. And there are a lot, the competition becomes really strong. And that's a must feature.
Yeah, for sure. Now, Matteo had a question on Slack and he said, you know, very interesting presentation. And he's he said in the past, as presented here, you know, in Decision Camp, it's like modelers, business analysts, and so on don't want to listen to the non-functional aspects like security, or even things like the REST URIs or ARN or that sort of thing. Now, based on the concepts you presented, could we say that subject matter experts and modelers have finally learned that they also can exploit what he refers to a mechanical sympathy with the system where decision services are actually deployed and used, so that people are having to understand a bit more about the technology?
And I would say it's like always, everything depends on particular customer and who is in charge and what they do, but it's certainly people on the right, DevOps people don't want to know about the logic. in majority of cases, and business people who define logic don't want to know about this. But at the same time, for example, business people tell, I want you not to show this information to this particular customer. And in this situation, show this, but never show this. And in this case, they have to tell this in business terms. They certainly don't want to use ARN or know what does it mean. And so they, in the, when they define decision service, it could be common work of IT and business. The same thing with glossary. Glossary has several fields, like, for example, type or Java attributes or JSON attributes. That's something with technical, and they have to work together. Like always, these results working in concert between IT, in this situation, IT plus DevOps and IT and developers and business people, when they work in concert, that's the best combination.
Okay, good. Any other questions? We have, you can type your question on Slack, or if you have a question you'd like to ask directly yourself, you can just raise your hand on Zoom and I will call on you there.
Okay.
First presentation of the day. It's always, you know, people are still getting warmed up.
Okay. So.
Okay. Well, we can leave it open for discussion, and while we can take like a little. Denny, go ahead.
Well, let me try to stir the pot a little bit. I really appreciated your presentation, and it's certainly completely real world grounded and. We see a lot of those same requirements. Where I'd like to stir the pot a little bit is with the arrow back to the continuous decision modeling. And it's not really a question, but it's more of a topic. Generally, we like to do some separation of concern in a model-driven architecture where you can isolate your platform-independent model from the platform-specific use of it, so that the same platform independent model can be reused in many different contexts. Here, it seemed to me, and you may correct me, that you're bringing the platform specific context right into the platform independent, making it so your whole chain, every time a new environment, a new use case comes in, I have to change the decision logic. So there is no separation of concern. Can you comment on that? Maybe I'm seeing things wrong.
No, it's valid. We had the same concerns always. And as I told you, it's not us, it's our customers who force us to change our philosophy. Separation of concerns, one of the guiding principle for decision modeling, and we did not want to know about deployment. But in real life, the same service is being invoked through Kafka from absolutely different sources, and it's being involved with the same service from Salesforce, passing different RESTful information through different JSON. It's being involved through 3-4 other services. And that's why I told you that the decision modeling itself took 1.5 months and all other things took another 2.5 or 3 months. And this is a very serious thing. So we wanted to find a compromise. We cannot satisfy all requirements and not to satisfy with separation of concerns. So we decided the decision model glossary is the right place to do, because that's the most important glue of the entire decision model, and it's maintained by both IT and business people. So this is something what is when you presented the importance of decision glossary, and that's basically, I mean, what I'm presenting is quite intact with your presentation, because glossary, the more we go forward, the more important glossary becomes. And it addresses these real world concerns, but certainly it doesn't solve all problems. And we probably just at the beginning of the shift. Let's see where we go.
Yeah, agreed. Thank you.
You're welcome.